Most of you know I'm Reverend Vicki Elder, the senior minister here at Unity of Monterey Bay. And it's my privilege to welcome you here today on behalf of Paulinda and Lindsay to celebrate the life of our dear friend, Brent Oaks. We ask that you please silence your cell phones as we begin breathing deeply into this now moment, connecting with that sacred space within us and with the God of each of our understanding. So collectively, we establish the presence, intention, and consciousness of beloved community, called together in this time and place by the light and love and joy that was and is Brent. Husband, father, son, brother, cousin, friend, generous servant, and eternal soul, who has now embarked on a new adventure within this timeless spiritual journey. And as we bid Brent well on the next chapter of his eternal journey, I share the words of poet and prophet Cahil Gibran on joy and sorrow. When you are joyous, look deep into your heart, and you shall find it only that which has given you sorrow is giving you joy. When you are sorrowful, look again in your heart, and you shall see that in truth you are weeping for that that has been your delight. Some say joy is greater than sorrow, and others say, nay, sorrow is the greater. But I say unto you, they are inseparable. So once again, let us join in a deep and collective breath. Letting it out with an audible sigh as we allow our hearts and minds to open wide to remember and celebrate Brent's life and to support and comfort one another in this process of letting go and letting in, of remembering and releasing, of experiencing both the pain of loss and the joy of having been blessed to share some of this life journey with and come to know the unique individual that was our friend, Brent. Native American traditions have a saying, it is a good day to die. It's a saying for those who live life fully in every moment, who express their love openly and wastefully without holding back, who freely give of their gifts and drink of life's riches, and who are blessed to have completed this journey with no regrets. It's an appropriate saying for Brent. All of us who knew him have been blessed by his generosity, his caring and kindness, and his wisdom. Brent was always ready with a welcoming smile, an offer of assistance, a warm hug, and a generous spirit, as well as a strong and grounded faith. And today, even as we grieve the loss of his physical presence, we give thanks that he is now free of all physical pain and limitation, free to soar with the angels, and free to see beyond the veil of separation that is the illusion of this earthly journey. So now we're going to invite the choir back up. Choir was a major part of Brent and Paulinda's membership here, and so we're going to be blessed by their music.
Thank you.
You all have a copy of Brent's obituary in your program, but I hope to share some of the more personal details of his life with you all today, from discussions with Paulinda and added memories from Lindsay and Brent's sister, all revealing the person that we came to know and love over the past 20 plus years. As noted in the obituary, Brent spent most of his youth in Massachusetts. In fact, he still had that little bit of an accent that could give away his Eastern roots. He attended and graduated from Wakefield High School. He participated in golf, skiing, and football during high school, and was also active in the Wakefield Baptist Church Youth Group. In fact, at one point, he considered going into the ministry. Brent especially enjoyed many summer adventures at his beloved Aunt Ruth's cottage on Seneca Lake in New York. His younger sister, Susan, said Brent was always inventive and had some sort of project going during these visits. Projects like attempting to build a tree house in a very skinny tree and then breaking his arm when the tree branch broke, dropping him to the ground. Or building a raft with a 5-foot tower out of scrap wood. He also created an Alamo with a fort in the woods for all of the kids, except he prohibited the little kids, including his sister, from using it. Typical big brother antics, she said. During his teenage years, Brent began working summers at Peckett's on Sugar Hill, a somewhat exclusive summer resort hotel catering to a well-to-do clientele. He was well-liked by the guests, working both as a waiter in the dining room and providing room service. But more importantly, Peckett's is where he ultimately met Paulinda, who was also working there as a waitress in 1965 as a summer college job. Paulinda shared with me that she noticed Brent right away, thinking that, especially if he'd been a couple inches taller, that he would be a real hunk. You shared it with me, you know. The two became friends, as they were both dating others at the time, and they got to know each other when they didn't have dates, with Brent teaching Paulinda how to play bridge. They didn't see each other much over the year, even though both of them were at the University of New Hampshire, but the next summer, they started dating when they were back at Beckett's again. And 6 years later, in 1973, they married. Paulinda shared that when they first got together, the two things they had in common were a collegiate dictionary and The Prophet by Cahil Gibran, the source of the chosen readings for today's service. Paulinda had started teaching elementary school back in Massachusetts after graduating from UNH, and Brent had opened an auto business where he restored and sold older cars, lots of Volvos, of course, but other makes as well, as well as auto parts for various older cars. They lived in the apartment above the business, and in 1976, Lindsay was born. Paulinda shared that Brent was a very good golfer and had even gotten a hole-in-one on a course that they played in Bermuda. But she added, Brent wasn't happy about the accomplishment because it had been kind of, in his opinion, a bad shot and just a fluke that had happened to ultimately fall into the hole. Attesting to his consistent drive to do things well and not just get things given to him. But what I found more revealing and consistent with the Brent I came to know was Paulinda's description of his infinite patience with her as he taught her to play golf and it took her 2 or 3 shots to his every one without ever complaining and just encouraging her along the way. California and Unity of Monterey Bay especially were truly blessed when Brent and Paulinda adopted California and the Central Coast for their new home in a warmer climate after Lindsay had graduated from graduate school. They originally planned to make the move in the summer of 1999, and Brent had hoped to open a Miracle Auto Painting franchise, and Paulinda was going to look for a teaching position. Their plans were delayed, however, when Brent was diagnosed with colon cancer. Nevertheless, after completing his initial treatment, they succeeded in moving here in December of 1999. Paulinda shared with me that they had a couple of young friends, a young man and a young woman, 20 and 21, who drove their truck all the way from Massachusetts here and had gotten the apartment that Brent had already come and found before they made the trip and had gotten all their things put in the apartment. So when they arrived, it was pretty well all set up. Though he had attained a building and began renovations, the return of Brent's illness prevented the auto painting dream from ever manifesting. But ever the resourceful guy, Brent shifted his focus and began obtaining and repairing and selling used forklifts and a variety of cars, of course, first from a local storage area and then from the yard of their house in Salinas. Brent also used these skills to help Unity of Monterey Bay get through some tough financial years by restoring cars that were donated to our church for resale and some well-needed profits. Whenever someone would donate a car, Brent would check it out and fix whatever needed fixing so we could put it in ads, and it got us through some tough years. I also experienced Brent's ingenuity and resourcefulness personally multiple times. After Rory had passed, when he would rescue me, or more often my son Kyle, from the side of the road with a flat tire or engine trouble, or restoring a car after an accident, he was always willing to show up to help resolve whatever the problem was, and I am forever grateful. Those were some tough years with my son, as many of you know, and it was great. Brent was just always accepting and affirming and showing up, providing Kyle with one Volvo after another to get him through those tough years. Brent was also regular with Polenda, as I said, in our choir, both when it was a regular Tuesday night event and later when it became a more spontaneous call for singers. And whenever we needed volunteers, like setting up tables at our Taste of Unity, you remember Taste of Unity at the Barnyard at Carmel, or helping with the barbecues that we would have in the parks up the way, Brent would step up. He was always one to say, be there and just show up and do whatever needed to be done. I also remember his challenging and insightful questions during our second hour Sunday services, when after the service we would just have a discussion, and he would always come up with some very intriguing. He could even stump Dan Schaefer, which takes something. He also attended, he and Belinda attended our Wednesday night classes during the early years, and he was always had great questions in those too. And even during COVID, when his health was failing, Brent was there in the Zoom classes so we could all stay connected. And he would just set his camera up so we could see him, even though he couldn't necessarily sit up always, and would participate as much as he could. Through the years, even as things worsened, his health worsened, Brent never talked about his health challenges. Belinda said he was like a cat with nine lives, surviving two serious auto accidents pre-Polinda, as well as a number of close calls during his cancer journey. As I noted earlier, Brent was someone who lived life as fully as he possibly could under whatever conditions life handed him. And we were all witness to and beneficiaries of his tenacity. I'll always remember his consistent good nature, how his smile always reached his eyes, his quiet but abundant generosity, his wry sense of humor, and his non-judgmental willingness to always offer a second and a third and even a fourth chance to anyone who needed it. These can be tough years for all of us. I remember Warren Lockwood liked to say, getting old ain't for wimps. But Brent was a role model in toughing it out with a smile, and we were all blessed to know him. He will be deeply missed. I'm going to invite the choir back up again. Thank you. So this is the time in the service that we invite others to come up and share their memories, their joys, their sharings that they had during their lives with Brent. And so whoever's ready to come up, you can just come up and stand at this mic down here and start with. It's always hard for be the first person. Thank you, Larry.
This hat has a meaning that Rory and Brent, they know. Well, it's just if I got goosebumps, I could put my hat on. Keep my head warm. Brent, I hope that I can be to somebody what you were to me. I know it won't be easy, even though you made it seem that way. I remember you telling me that I always make things bigger than they are. It was this time when he had this big building, I think it was about a block long in Salinas, and I was gonna paint it for him. I'm a painter, and I was like, we need a boom, and we need to get some guys, and we need all this. And he was like, just paint the damn thing. you don't need to just paint the damn thing. And he probably said more than that. Anyway, I had the opportunity to see him light up on many occasions. He loved a good burger, and when I worked on his building, we would often go to Burger King, and he would treat. And I don't know if he was lit up for the burger he was eating or just watching me eat that burger, but he lit up. He had a way of lighting up. There was many precious times that Brent and I spent together. There was one time he let me drive his big old truck, and it had a long, really long trailer on it, and it had a forklift on the back of the trailer. And I had never driven anything that big and long before. We were going to deliver a forklift for him. We got lost, but he didn't care. Nothing was a big thing to Brent. And so he was like, speed up a little bit, because I was being careful. And I think this is the first time he ever really sunk down in a seat and got scared. But I was really happy to be able to do that. But yeah, we had some really good times again. And I love Brent. And there was another time we went to the men's retreat, and I think he was late, and I went with a couple of other guys, but he came, and I rode back with him. He had a Porsche, a black Porsche. Something happened on the way back, and we had to pull over. He went in the trunk, found some wire or something, and raised the hood up and fixed the Porsche real quick, and we made it back. I do love and miss him. He taught me a lot. I won't forget him. I remember and cherish the things that, that we shared together.
Well, my experience with Brent was a little bit different. I'm not a mechanic. I was not an apprentice. I was his helper, and not a very good one sometimes. He was a master mechanic. He knew a lot of things. And he would try to provide encyclopedic knowledge to me. And I didn't know the difference between that bolt in the clutch and the wheel. And I was like, okay, we try. He was a very generous person. He shared a lot of things with me. I used to joke with him. I will arrive to his house, talk to Paulinda, then go and talk to Brent. And then we talk about what we will do on the day. Sometimes we were able to do something. Sometimes we couldn't do anything. But we still have fun. We joke. We have a great time. He was a very generous man, I will say again. He always have a lot of patience. Once in a while, he will be like, oh, my God, this guy needs to go to school and learn something. Because English is my second language. So he will say something to me. I will like, Brent, let me grab my phone. Why? I need to translate that. So I will translate from mechanic to English, English to Spanish, and then I will be like, nope, I don't even know what this thing is. So he will clearly send me, okay, look at this picture, okay? Can you find it? I will try. Then I will go into the car of the forklift, come back an hour later, all covered in grease, Paulinda can be the witness of that. And I was like, Brent, I find it. Can you move it? I had no idea how to move it. And he would be patient, and he would tell me, just go and get a tool. And I was like, okay, I have a little toolbox. You have more tools than Home Depot. So, and I would go and start grabbing a whole bunch of tools, walking with him, and he would be like, I was laughing, that one. Okay. And for me, it was a really good experience. He was very knowledgeable. He was able to explain to somebody that didn't know anything about cars. He would, had that wisdom that comes with age. That's the only way to learn things is living, working on them. And he was very generous with his time and sharing a lot of things with me. So thank you, Brent. Thank you.
Paul and then Lindsay and everyone here. Very moving for me to be back here today among many friends and new faces. Some of you may know that, well, I'm Steve Maynard, also known as Rep Steve. Olivia and I came here in 1997 and were at the church until 2002, and then with the help of Vicki and Rory and another church, they sponsored me to go to Unity School, where I became ordained. And not long after my ordination, I came back to Pioneer's Unity Church in Salinas, called Unity of Salinas. And Paulinda and Brent, while their first love was always Unity of Monterey Bay, they were pillars of our community, our small fledgling community, for the 3 years that we were in Salinas. And that meant so much to me. They'd come here and get a good sermon on Sunday morning. And at first we had evening services we called Evensong. And they would come and endure the message of a rookie minister. And I think they came for the food, because we always had potluck. But they brought potluck too. So. It was a wonderful thing having Brent and Paulinda in our community in Salinas. And I noticed that today there are at least the same number of former Unity Salinas participants as there were in the choir, including Brent, and both in the choir and including Brent, and in terms of Unity Salinas participants. Brent, one of the things we did, we always had classes on Thursday nights, and I never taught any of the traditional Unity classes. I remember I counted once, I think, in the 3 years, we had 15 different classes ranging from 4 weeks to 10 weeks. And I'm always a bit of a contrarian, so I had to teach stuff that was not strictly Unity. but was spiritual and had some important things. And I think Brent may have joined us because, as Olivia says, of him, he was a world-class contrarian. And he would come to class, and he'd sit there quietly for quite a while, and then it would get quiet, and Brent, you look like you have something on your mind. And out of his sort of New England viewpoint, he'd ask a zinger that stumped, I mean, they've stumped Dan, it stumped you, and probably you too, Michelle. It was always causing me to pause, and I'm going like, okay, how do I deal with this? And at first I was sort of, as a new minister, like, well, I need to provide the answer. And then I got to the point of saying, oh, that's an interesting question. What do you think, Brett? Aha! And then the wisdom came out. I really grew to love Brent for a variety of reasons, many of which you shared, Vicki, in your beautiful talk about him. But I remember the first time that I went to that building, his warehouse, paint shop, auto repair in Salinas, and I walked around. He showed me around, and we were walking around this warehouse. It was huge. It was cavernous. And I started looking at all the cars, and they were all Volvo 740s. I go like, you must like Volvo 740s. Yeah, they're the best car, the only car to drive. How many do you have? Oh, I don't know. And so I walked around, and I counted. I don't remember the exact count, but there were between 50 and 75 Volvos. It was a lot of cars. Do you know how many you had? I mean, I go like, wow, is that right? It was filled with cars? And, you know, some of them were in working order. Some of them I think he was using for parts. If we ever needed a car, he would lend us the car, which happened a couple times. And he was kind of like unity as practical Christianity. He was practical Volvo. You know, he didn't really care too much about the aesthetics. Does it work? Yeah, it works. And what it looks like? Well, that's your problem, you know? When we got to Salinas initially, we lived in an apartment, and eventually we found a house to rent, and Brent said, oh, I'll help you move. And I said, oh, that's okay. He said, yeah, we can use my truck. And I thought, oh, that's good. So we met at, we had a bunch of stuff in storage, in a storage unit, and we met at the storage unit, and what I discovered, it was a flatbed truck with no sides or anything. And I'm going like, dang. We loaded all the furniture on there, and we had to drive all through Salinas, and I'm going, following behind him, and I'm like, what's going to fall off here? But no, you know, Brent was practical unity, practical Volvo, and practically a mover. So he was always generous, as you pointed out, as was Paulinda and Lindsay. We spent several holidays together at your house, sharing Christmas or Thanksgiving dinner, and you couldn't find a better thing and a better person than Brent. And what I remember most, every time I encounter Brent, what do I see? Stetson hat, rosy cheeks, a wry smile, and sparkling eyes. And the eyes got me every time. God bless you, Brent, on your onward journey. Thank you.
My name is John Heil, and I am a member of this church, and I grew up in New Hampshire. And as Brent and Paulinda and I quickly discovered about each other. You can take the boy out of New Hampshire, but you can't take New Hampshire out of the boy or his wife. It was such a pleasure when Kathy and I first came into this church to meet them and hear that accent and that practicality and almost to the point of cheapness, although I wouldn't say I'm too cheap, but maybe Brent was. And he helped with automotive stuff at the drop of a hat, especially if you were willing to work on it under his tutelage. This was his real strong suit. You got something you need to fix? Well, bring it over. Let's see what we can do. So first we fixed an old Subaru brake problem. And I love the way he referred to the owner's manual as being one wheel. He says, we're working on this one. Go over and look at the owner's manual, which is the other wheel on the same car. but his strength of character came out at other moments. I had a trailer for my sailboat that needed a new axle because the other one was bent. And I took the trailer over to his place, and he was going to take care of it. And he ordered all the stuff to do it, and he put it all together, and he put it together with the axle on the top of the frame instead of the bottom of the frame. So when I got there, I hooked it to my car and said, this doesn't seem quite right, Brent. And that's when he totally said, I can't believe it, but I screwed it up. and it was like, no worries, Brent, I can fix this. I just unbolted and take it, and we took it home, took care of it. But he was so quick to admit when his thinking wasn't clear or when he'd made that kind of an error, and he would say so right to you right away. There was no hemming or hawing about that at any point. So I value Palinda's friendship immensely, as I did value Brent's. And we'll all miss him. He was a great guy.
I'm Denise Headland. And Brent, like Vicky said, helped my son as well with cars, and he didn't have one at the time. And so again, he got, what do you think he gave him to try? A Volvo, yes. And did it look great? No, but it worked fabulous. And he had Joe go out there and a couple times, so it was really, really helpful for us. And Brent in the choir was just a great guy. He had a trouble reading music all the time, and he would listen really well. And he sang bass. He's a fellow bass with all the bass, like Larry over there and John. And when we had rehearsals, fun things at my house, he would come. And I just like what John said about, or what Steve said about the rosy cheeks. Some of the pictures that I have of him sitting there and with his big smile and his sparkly eyes, but the rosy cheeks get you every time. So thank you, Brent, for all that you did and all you were. And are. Thank you.
Brent, I got a couple of Volvos from Brent. Okay, and the first one broke down all the time and it was terrible, and I just was cursing it and thinking this is the worst. Never want another one again. And then got a second one from him, and it was a good Volvo. And I drove that Volvo all the way up to Humboldt to see my daughter. And that was kind of a miracle that I did that. And I made it there and back, no trouble. I just remember him, as everybody has said, he was very generous, and he just would do things to surprise you, like with my, this is later on, a long time later, I had another car, not from Brent, and the hood was, well, he painted that car at some point, and then later on, the hood was just cruddy, and it had been, you know, just full of under a tree that had sap on it. And anyway, he ended up surprising me and painting the hood, and it was just, I was elated, I was so excited out of my mind about it. And so I just always remembered that about him, that really stood out to me. And then another thing is that I always noticed that he was so dedicated to Paulinda and to Lindsay, and I was just really impressed with his dedication to his family. And he went to like every choir rehearsal and every class, and anything that Paulinda was involved in, he was there, right there. And I really admire that. I remember, he liked to surprise people. And I believe, if I got this right, he surprised Paulinda on her birthday and had Lindsay flown here from New York. Was that is that correct? No. Anyway, I love that, and I personally love surprises, and I really admired that in him. And I'm very grateful to all that Brent gave, and yeah, he was a great guy.
I've been coming to Unity for a while, and all the while I've come, Paulinda and Brent have been here, and I never knew Brent at all. I don't know that we ever exchanged a single word, except maybe if we were happened to be by each other at a potluck. Well, that looks good. Yeah, that looks good. It was so quiet, and we just didn't really have a way to exchange a way of getting to know each other. But during the time of COVID, we had classes online, and Brent would be in his bed with his pillow, and he'd adjust the camera, and the camera was always maybe just catching his eyes. And I always wanted to see his face, but I thought, okay. And we'd have our class, and he would have something to say, and it would be quiet for a moment, and I would think, oh, come on. You know, maybe he's not feeling well, it's so quiet. Oh, come on, Brent. And then he'd start to talk, and he was so solid and so clear and so crisp, and his words were so perfect. They had a cadence, they had a purpose, they wrapped it up, and I was completely blown away. I was so excited and so enlightened by just a few words, that the insight that he had on that topic was different. It just showed the depth where he was coming from. And so as courses continued, I just looked forward to what he would say, because I knew I was in for a gem. And so of the maybe 15 sentences of all the years of coming here that I heard from Brent, I'm just so grateful.
So. Many of you know me that I don't usually stand up in front of people and talk, but I just couldn't let this pass because everything that you've said about Brent is Brent. Picture this, Sunday morning, maybe about 9 o'clock. I lived in Prunedale. I'm driving my brand new, for me, used vehicle down the road, and it decides to die. I'm on the side of the road by myself. I don't know where Sue was, but she was somewhere, but not with me. I get on the phone and say, I'm stuck here. I'm going to be late or not even make church at all. It wasn't 20 minutes later. This truck, tow truck, shows up, parks behind me. Guess who? Brent. I was like, how did, I don't even know how he knew. Maybe he just kind of knew. We hooked up the car, or it was kind of a van thing. We made it to church on time. I have no idea where he parked the darn thing, but we both made it to church on time. And that was, for me, the essence of Brent. He just seemed to be at the right place, at the right time, doing the right thing, and I blessed him every day I knew it. Thank you.
We just wanted to thank everybody. I don't want to stop naming names and to thank people because I'll forget somebody, and I don't want to do that. But friends and family in Iowa and in New England that couldn't be here, that hopefully are able to watch it on Facebook, my neighbors and friends that in Salinas and in the area that have just come forward and helped so much. Lindsay especially, I want to thank, because she's just been there for me and keeps an eye on me twice a week, once with Zoom and once with a phone call. We talk, and especially the Unity family. I don't know where I'd be without this group. They were just so supportive. And I think I mentioned it at Soul Gardeners. I have felt within the last several months, and even before Brent died, that that the whole universe had its arms wrapped around me and was giving me this great hug and support. I can't imagine where I would be if this had not happened, if this group was not here. You are my family. When my close family is not nearby, I just feel that you're here as my family. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here in person and online. And just to add to my mom's sentiments, it wasn't very long after my parents moved to California in 1999. I was still on the East Coast. I am still on the East Coast. And my dad started trying to talk me into moving to California. And my response at the time was, like, you just moved 3,000 miles away from me. Like, this isn't how this works. But getting to know this family, this group, my parents' extended family here at Unity of Monterey Bay and in the greater Monterey and Salinas area, I understand why he felt this was his true new home. And thank you all.
Well, I have to say, am I on? No. I have to say that as a Swede, I approve of all of this Volvo business.
thanks. I think Brent single-handedly, like, you know, popularized Volvo in this part of the world or something. So, and I also was a couple, once or twice, the benefit of his mechanics, his generous mechanics help, and so I'm grateful for that. I've loved hearing what everyone has had to share today. I just want to add that, you know, it's been mentioned a number of times, both Brent and Pauline does, but today we're talking about Brent, his dedication to this church and to being involved in this church and attending classes and, you know, even when it was on Zoom, always being there. And so I hope this is okay, but one of the ways I'm going to remember Brent is lying in the pew. Because, you know, when his health got to a point where he couldn't sit up through the service, he would just lie down. Do you know how many people would not come to church, you know? But he was going to be here anyway. And he'd be lying there. We didn't care. We knew that's Brent. Oh, yeah, that's Brent. He lies down. That's just, you know. And so that level of dedication and commitment, both to his own spiritual walk as well as to this community, that is what will not be forgotten about him. One other thing I have to say is that every single person that has gotten up today, I don't know if you noticed, has mentioned one word over and over again, and that is generosity. And Brent was generous with his money. He was generous with his time. He was clearly generous with his teaching of mechanics, generous with his patience for people, and generous with his friendship. And as I was sitting there hearing that word coming up, and that is the word that I would have used to describe him too, and I thought, you know, to have your celebration of life and have, what, 10, 12 people get up and every single one of them say that you were generous? Wow. I'm humbled by that. It's probably not what y'all would say about me, and not the first word that would come to your mind. But that, you know, I was so struck by that. What a life well lived, that every person that gets up to speak at your memorial mentions your generosity. So I just want to leave that thought sort of hanging there. That's what we celebrate today, is this wonderful man and his generosity and his goodness and his kindness and clearly his rosy cheeks and his sparkling eyes. So thank you, everyone, for your sharing that has allowed us all to remember this wonderful man and his life. And as Vicki mentioned before, The Prophet was a book that when they came together, Pauline and Brent both had a copy. That was the one book that they both had, that and the dictionary, that they both had a copy of. And so it clearly was a special book to them, and I'm going to share these words with you. From the prophet on death. Then Almitra spoke, saying, "We would ask now of death." And he said, "You would know the secret of death, but how shall you find it unless you seek it in the heart of life? The owl whose night-bound eyes are blind unto the day cannot unveil the mystery of light. If you would indeed behold the spirit of death, open your heart wide unto the body of life. If you would indeed, for life and death are one, even as the river and the sea are one. In the depth of your hopes and desires lies your silent knowledge of the beyond. And like seeds dreaming beneath the snow, your heart dreams of spring. Trust the dreams. For in them is hidden the gate to eternity. Your fear of death is but the trembling of the shepherd when he stands before the king whose hand is to be laid upon him in honor. Is the shepherd not joyful beneath his trembling that he shall wear the mark of the king? Yet is he not more mindful of his trembling? For what is it to die? But to stand naked in the wind and to melt into the sun? And what is it to cease breathing, but to free the breath from its restless tides, that it may rise and expand and seek God unencumbered? Only when you drink from the river of silence shall you indeed sing. And when you have reached the mountaintop, then you shall begin to climb. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then shall you truly dance. And I think now Lindsay has a special slideshow, and it's going to begin with a song.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times when I thought more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way. It was my way.
One of the greatest gifts we can give to one another and the world is that of a loving thought. And one of the ways we begin to heal is to share. So as we bring this formal part of Brent's celebration of life to a close and move on into the reception, there's an invitation to continue sharing your stories and memories and thoughts of Brent with one another, and especially with Paulinda and Lindsay. And so we'll end this portion of the celebration with the words of Unity's poet laureate, James Dillett Freeman. He has put on invisibility. Dear God, I cannot see, but this I know. Although the road ascends and passes from my sight, there will be no night. That you will take him gently by the hand and lead him on along the road of life that never ends. And he will find that it is not death, but dawn. I do not doubt that you are there as here, and you will hold him dear. Our life did not begin with birth. It is not of this earth. And this that we call death is no more than the opening and closing of a door. And in your house, how many rooms must be beyond this one where we rest momently? Dear Lord, we give thanks for the faith that frees, for the love that knows it cannot lose its own, for the love that, looking through the shadow, sees that you and he and we are ever one. Amen. Again, Paulinda and Lindsay invite you downstairs for a reception after the last performance by the choir. Thank you to the choir, and join us downstairs.